princess at the lotus feet of Dronacharya. He says, it is all because of you, my dear spiritual master, that today I have become such a great archer. So Dronacharya then says, if you think I am your spiritual master, then you must give me dakshina, isn't it? Some dakshina must be there. It is tradition. So what are you going to give? And he said, I will give you anything. Tell me. And he said, very simple. Chop off your right thumb and give it to me. In our sastras, there's a lot of chopping. Eh? Chopping head, chopping thumb. And here he says, chop off the thumb. So when he chops off the thumb, he immediately chops off the thumb, by the way. And with a smile, he gives the thumb as dakshina. Now, if you read Mahabharata and you read many commentators, they will tell you the exact opposite of what Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur Maharaj will say. They will say that Ekalavya displayed what a great disciple he was to cut off his thumb and give it to his guru. But the true bona fide Gaudiya Vaishnavas, they tell you that actually Ekalavya is an example of how not to be a disciple. Because Dronacharya's first instruction to Ekalavya was don't take up archery. And the very first instruction of his spiritual master, he chose to disobey. Therefore, he was not submissive. He embarked on his own desire. He embarked on his own mental concoction. He never checked with Guru. He never checked with Sadhu. And he never checked with Shastra. And this is the road to regress in devotional service. The moment as devotees we become puffed up and we think, now I don't need the senior devotees, I don't need the association of devotees, I can do it all on my own. In fact, everyone needs my association. The moment we start thinking that way, that day is the start of the end of our devotional service. So Ekalavya could not become victorious because Dronacharya checked him. And Arjuna became victorious because Arjuna was 100% following the instructions of Dronacharya. Mahabharata tells us if Arjuna had been told to stop archery, he was so obedient to Dronacharya, he would have done so. But because it was Krishna's plan, he became the greatest archer. So this is the meaning of submission and this is the meaning of obedience. We must become very obedient. In Mahabharata, the concept of obedience is given so nicely that even in material world, it is argued by Vyas Bhagavan, even in material world, if one is obedient to the laws of nature, one finds that he is quite harmonious with everything. It is only because we have broken away from the natural laws of material nature that we are becoming disturbed. That's why our philosophy says simple living and high thinking. There is a very nice episode in Mahabharata which is also instructive in the guru-disciple relationship because it shows us the value of obedience. You all know that there was a personality known as Brihaspati and he was the guru of the Devatas. Every time the Devatas did not obey Brihaspati, Bhagavatam tells us they lost their powers and they lost their fights to the demons. The demons' only qualification of being stronger than the Devatas was that they 100% followed Sukracharya. Even though Sukracharya was not really a bona fide spiritual master, even then, because they were simply obedient to him, they were in a better position sometimes in Bhagavatam than the Devatas because the Devatas refused to follow Brihaspati. And one time the Devatas were in such a bad state, Bhagavatam tells us, that they had lost all powers. So they didn't know what to do. So Brihaspati then told that someone must go to Sukracharya, enemy camp, and he must learn the art of Amrita Sanjivani. If you learn that mantra, those who die on the battlefield, Sukracharya will chant, and my God, he will become revived. So the Devatas were thinking, who will go and sit down with Sukracharya to learn this? Because Sukracharya is not going to give this very easily. Finally, his son, Kacha, says, I will go, father. I will obey your orders to get Amrita Sanjivani and I will not come back and I will not be diverted in my attention until I have attained what you have instructed me. So Kacha goes now. And when he approaches Sukracharya, he says, I want to become your disciple. Sukracharya says, do you think I'm so foolish? You are the son of my arch enemy's guru, Brihaspati, and you think I will accept you. But Kacha stayed 1 year at the feet of Sukracharya just outside his ashram and refused to budge. And after 1 year, Sukracharya thought, this one is very submissive. Maybe I have to teach him. He became pleased. That is why Shastras tell us, even in material world, If you work with someone and you're submissive by nature, you find that people like you. And you find that your relationships improve because you learn how to show proper respect. Not out of hypocrisy, but out of genuine respect. How much more respect must we have for the representative of the spiritual, of the Supreme Personality of Godhead? This is important. So Kacha then stayed and served Sukracharya. Every time Sukracharya was chanting mantras, he taught them to Kacha. He taught all the mantras except Amrita Sanjeevani. Now, after a while, Sukracharya had a daughter and her name was Devayani. Devayani started liking this Kacha. And eventually she was thinking, I want to marry him. Of course, Sukracharya was sold out to his daughter. Only child, pampered her like anything. Anything she wanted, gave her. One day, Sukracharya decided, I will send Kacha out to take care of the cows. Now the demons, his disciples, were becoming a little bit concerned. They knew Sukracharya was being wooed by Kacha for Amrita Sanjeevani, because they had spies in the opposite camp. So they were thinking, why is Sukracharya giving this man so much chance? Better we kill him ourselves. So one evening when Kacha goes out with the cows, he never comes back. Because the demons waylay him in the forest. They chop him into little pieces. Yes, chopping again. And after chopping him into little pieces, they then throw him into the sea. And after that, the whole night, you know, Devayani could not sleep because she was in love with Kacha. Sukracharya was there and he was in love with his daughter because he said, my dear daughter, don't look so sad. Tell me what I can do for you. She said, Father, I will not be happy until you bring Kacha back. They must have killed him. You know Amrita Sanjeevani. Use it. So Sukracharya said, I will use it. So he used Amrita Sanjeevani and Kacha comes back to life. Demons are not happy. Second time they waylay him again, 2 days later. This time they chop him up into small pieces. They grind the pieces and they then throw it into the ocean. And again Devayani is waiting for one night. And again she says, Sukracharya, my dear father, please bring him back. Sukracharya chants Amrita Sanjeevani, he comes back. But when every time Kacha comes back, he humbly asks Sukracharya, please give me Amrita Sanjeevani. Sukracharya says, no, you are dying all the time, so better I know the mantra. I will get you alive. What's the point of you knowing the mantra? You'll die. So no point. The third time the demons decided, now we'll do one thing. They cut him into small pieces. They grinded him into smaller pieces. They grinded all the flesh into powder form. They put the powder into an alcoholic beverage that Sukracharya always liked. Sukracharya liked alcoholic beverages because he had association of demons, you know. Demons like, so he also liked. So they put that into the water, into the alcoholic beverage. They stirred it very nicely. They came before Sukracharya and said, Sukracharya, today we have some alcoholic beverage. The one that you like particularly, it's here right now. Sukracharya thought, okay. Devayani was thinking, Father, where is Kacha? He thought, let Kacha wait. Let me drink my beverage. He drinks the beverage and then he realizes Kacha is in my stomach. Now, if Kacha is in my stomach, he explains to his daughter, if I chant Amrita Sanjeevani, he will come out of my stomach, but I will die. You decide whether you want father or you want your husband to be. She said, I want both. You somehow do whatever you have to do and you get me him. Now inside he hears Kacha's voice. Kacha speaks. He says, my dear Sukracharya, maybe now it's time for you to teach me Amrita Sanjeevani. Because if you teach me that, I will remember it. And when I come to life and you are dead, I will chant it. Then we are both alive and everything is all right. And Sukracharya that day, Mahabharata says, realize the value of a disciple who is so obedient to the order of his spiritual master that the power and blessings of Brihaspati carried Kacha through this entire episode. And the will of providence was arranged in such a way that Sukracharya had no choice but to teach Amrita Sanjeevani on the strength of Kacha's obedience to his spiritual master. And when he learned that science, he took leave of Sukracharya. He goes back to Brihaspati. They teach the devatas and the devatas conquer the demons. So Mahabharata and all our sastras are full of this important point that if you want to make advancement, please be grateful to your spiritual master. Be a menial servant before the spiritual master. And spiritual master does not only mean Diksha. All the devotees who have somehow or another given you Krishna consciousness, respect them and follow their footsteps. Take association of them. And if you take association from them and become submissive and learn, then Krishna becomes very happy. And Krishna becomes very happy when we serve the devotees of the Lord. Bhaktai bhakta jana priyaha. This is the conclusion of this verse. That Krishna confirms in the 9th canto, 4th chapter, 63rd verse. Aham bhakta paradino hi aswatantra ivadvija sadhu bi grista hriddayo bhaktai bhakta jana priyaha. He says that I have no independence because I'm totally attached to my pure devotees. And then he says the last line, which is very important for all of us. He says, what to speak of my pure devotees? Even the devotees of my devotees, I become pleased with. I give you one nice example from Ramayana. Vibhishana, you all know, was the very exalted brother of Ravana. Complete opposite, day and night. Vibhishana was a devotee of Lord Ram, and Ravana was enemy number one of Lord Ram. Vibhishana gave good advice to Ravana. Please stop this nonsense and surrender Sita. But Ravana became so angry with Vibhishana, instead of hearing him and following his siksha, he discarded him. When Vibhishana was thrown out of the palace and decided, I better leave the palace, he looked around at all the other Rakshasas and he asked them, is there anyone here who wants to follow me? And of course, everybody wanted to follow Ravana. But there were four Rakshasas who were always serving Vibhishana and they wanted his association. So they followed him. In the night, they left Lanka. And in the same night, they reached the shores where Lord Ram and all the Vanaras were camped. The moment Sugriva, Angada and a few other Vanaras realized that there is an intruder in the camp, they stopped Vibhishana and they said, who are you? He said, I'm Vibhishana and I've come to take shelter of Lord Ram. And then Angada says that I am suspicious of your motive. It must be that you're sent as a spy of Ravana because after all, you are his brother. So how can it be that you're coming to surrender to Lord Ram? But Vibhishana said, I'm really coming to surrender before Lord Ram. And Angada and all the others who were there, they refused to let Vibhishana through. Vibhishana had to very patiently explain over and over and over that he is a surrendered soul to Lord Ram. By the time morning came, Lord Ram was wondering, where is all this commotion coming from? When he came out and he saw Vibhishana, he said, what is stopping Vibhishana? And they all said their suspicions. And immediately Lord Ram went to Vibhishana and he embraces him very tightly. And he says that Vibhishana is really a devotee. And because he's a devotee, I welcome him into the camp. The moment Lord Ram said he's devotee, immediately the great devotees, Vanaras, they said, oh, if Lord Ram has accepted him, then what's the problem? Vibhishana, now you have your pass. Entry pass is there. You can enter. Now, the moment Vibhishana starts walking, don't forget, all this time, the four Rakshasas were behind Vibhishana, waiting for their master to go through. The moment Vibhishana went through, the Vanaras stopped these four. Who are you four? Now they thought, my God, is it going to be another whole night for us to convince them that we are also with Vibhishana? Or we are also devotees of Lord Ram? So then the Rakshasas said something very simple. They said, we are actually following Vibhishana. We are surrendered to him. And the moment the Vanaras heard that, they said, oh, you're surrendered to that great personality. You can come very easily. They gave hell to Vibhishana. But it was so easy for the devotees of the great devotees to enter into the kingdom of God. A very recent example I can give before we end this discourse is the example of Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya and Amogha Leela in Chaitanya Leela. If you read Madhya Leela, you find Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya was a great devotee of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and the Lord. And they had very, very close, intimate relationship. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu very often would go to Bhattacharya's house after going to Jagannath temple. One day, Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya invited him and said, please come, my Lord, and have a feast in my house. Bhattacharya was very insistent. But Mahaprabhu said, I'm sannyasi. How can I eat chapan bhog? Only Jagannath eats chapan bhog. But then Bhattacharya says, we know in our hearts that you are the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So please come and eat. So Mahaprabhu smiled. He said, I'll come. Bhattacharya had a son-in-law known as Amogha Leela. Amogha Leela was just the opposite of his father-in-law. Whereas Bhattacharya was a great devotee, Amogha Leela was criticizer number one, always finding fault. The moment Mahaprabhu came and sat down to have prasadam, what happened? When he started eating so many different arrangements of dishes, suddenly Amoghalila spoke very loudly in the house. What kind of sannyasi is this Mahaprabhu? So many kinds of dishes he's eating, but he's supposed to control his senses. This is very bad. So when Bhattacharya heard that, he came running to beat his son-in-law. But Amoghalila ran out. Again he came back. And again he repeated the same thing. And this time Bhattacharya took a big stick to knock him. But by then he had fled. Bhattacharya comes before Mahaprabhu with tears in his eyes. And he says, today, instead of glorifying Lord, I have offended you. I should go to hell. My son-in-law is definitely going to hell. And I must go to hell with him also. But see, Mahaprabhu, never forget that Krishna, Mahaprabhu, they are the prime examples of the supreme spiritual masters. And Mahaprabhu told Bhattacharya, why are you making such a big fuss? He's like your son. And anyway, what he says may be true. I am a sannyasi. Why am I eating so much? This is the compassion of the spiritual master because it is coming from the Supreme Lord. But Bhattacharya was very sad. And Mahaprabhu, after eating, he goes. Later in the evening, Gopinath Acharya comes to see Mahaprabhu. And he tells him, I've got news for you. You remember that Amoghalila who criticized you in the morning? He's dying of cholera in the evening. And he's in a small shack just at the edge of the village. Because it's infectious, he's alone. Immediately, Mahaprabhu gets up and runs to the shed. And all the devotees are thinking, why is Mahaprabhu doing that? This is justice for what he has done. But Mahaprabhu goes into the shed. It is dark. And Chaitanya Mangal tells us that Amoghalila is lying down on a mat. And he's feeling very, very sick. And when Mahaprabhu knocks on the door, immediately he says, go away, I'm infectious, I'm dying. Mahaprabhu enters the room. And if you see some pictures and paintings in Chaitanya Charitamrita, you see that Mahaprabhu was kneeling and the dying Amoghalila was on the straw mat. Mahaprabhu takes his hand, he puts it on the heart of Amoghalila and he says, Amogh, Krishna is in your heart. You are a Brahmana. Why are you being so offensive? Please cleanse yourself of all these offenses. And the moment the Lord's hand touches the heart of Amoghalila, immediately all desires for sense enjoyment, they leave his heart. And he stands up in ecstasy and starts chanting, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And at that point of time, he becomes a great devotee of the Lord. Now, Mahaprabhu tells him one thing which is relevant to what we are saying in today's verse. Mahaprabhu tells him, I did not deliver you for any other reason except that the object of my affection is Sarvabhauma Bhattacharya. And because you are related to him, it is my duty to relieve you of your pain and suffering. Then he says, what to speak of you who are the son-in-law of Bhattacharya? Even the maid who is working in his house, the servants who are serving in his house, and his dog who is in the house also, they are all very dear to me. This proves to us a very important point. That if one catches the lotus feet of the spiritual master or the exalted devotees of the Lord who are always daily thinking, serving and always in remembrance of Krishna, if we somehow or another become submissive to them, if we render service to them, if we approach them, then what happens? Because the Lord becomes so pleased that you have approached such a great devotee, on the strength of that devotee's purity, the Lord favors the fallen souls like us. And this Bhattacharya's example is a prime example to understand and to relish. We may not have the qualification to approach Krishna directly, but if we approach Krishna through the exalted devotees of the Lord, then definitely Krishna becomes very pleased. And this is the royal road to approaching a spiritual master. If we go on our own to approach Krishna directly, we will find that we become very puffed up. Hiranyakashipu, Ravana tried to construct, a stairway to heaven. And after that, he thought he can construct a stairway to the spiritual world. But with all the physical prowess, Ravana was finished. Hiranyakashipu thought just by the lifting of his eyebrow, the whole inhabitants of the three worlds will come under him. But he himself was under his own senses, could not control them. because he thought that he's Guru. He thought, I don't need spiritual master. So, Prabhu's Matajis, one very important thing that we must understand in devotional service, if we really want to become devotees of the Lord, if we want to fulfill our true occupation, and that is to render devotional service, then please hear what Lord Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita. It is very straightforward. Just approach the bona fide spiritual master. Approach him with submission. Approach him to render service. And by doing that, Prabhupada guarantees, and Krishna guarantees, that if we do that, then if you look at 435, it's amazing, the verse 435, having obtained real knowledge from a self-realized soul, you will never fall again into such illusion. Krishna guarantees that we will never fall again into this world, provided we follow the formula that Krishna is giving. If we think Krishna made a formula, but I have another formula, then we will just travel and travel and wander in this material world, thinking that we will find happiness. But true happiness comes at the lotus feet of Tadva Darshinaha, one who has seen Krishna, one who has realized Krishna. Jai Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam ki.
Jai.
Jai Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki.
Jai.
Anantakuri Vaishnavinda ki.
Jai.
Srila Prabhupada ki.
Jai.
Thai Gaura Premanande. Are there any questions, some realizations that you would like to share? That would be nice. Maybe we can take one or two before we move on.
Scriptures and philosophy, but you make it so easy that even I understand. And on this behalf, I would like to also thank Amit Krishna Prabhu and Leena Mataji, I don't know where they are, to arrange such a nice get-together, and Priya and Ajay to bring me here, otherwise I would have been sleeping somewhere.
But it's good to see you, Prabhu.
And it was fantastic. I cannot say more than
that. Actually, I come to Denmark not to give association. I come to take association. So that is why I come here, because it is a very inspiring congregation. Thank you. Mataji, you have a question?
I have a question, because all the examples that you told, they are all from a Satyuga and another Yuga. We live in Kali Yuga. He gets sometimes confused who is the real bona fide spiritual master. We can see that many have bits, elements, many personalities all around us are very good in very small phases, but there are some pluses and minuses everywhere. They're also human like us. I mean, we are much lower than them.
Yes.
But and so we are a bit confused, we ordinary people here.
Yes.
We try to take blessings of everybody, but then we are quite confused sometimes.
Yeah. And when you get confused and you get blessings from everyone, then the confusion increases actually sometimes. That is true.
So, how do we tackle that?
Yeah. I can share with you some points that Prabhupada brought up, which is very useful. The first point that's really nice is, once when Prabhupada was, I think, in Nairobi or in Africa, the devotees were reading from Bhagavatam and there were all these wonderful characteristics of pure devotees listed. And after a while, they came to Prabhupada and they said, we look around everywhere and nobody has these characteristics. So, how will we surrender? And Prabhupada, if you're not here, then what do we do? You know? And Prabhupada made a very powerful statement. I'll just quote him as he said it. Prabhupada was fond of using the word rascal sometimes. You know that. He could use it, we can't. But I'm just repeating what he said. He said, rascal, he told the person who asked. Except for you, everyone else is a pure devotee. Prabhupada was not speaking from the point of that everyone has purity 100%, as you said correctly. But Prabhupada was trying to correct the mentality when we come to devotional service. We tend to try and shop. Prabhupada used the word shop because we understandably want to be very clear before we surrender. We want to be sure that we want to surrender to the bona fide spiritual master. So caution on our part is natural. However, Prabhupada warns us that if you read Shastras, if you daily read Bhagavatam, if you daily read Bhagavad Gita, all the nice characteristics of devotees are actually given, Mataji. And we have, by the blessings of Srila Prabhupada, so many wonderful spiritual masters in our movement. They were each of them blessed by Srila Prabhupada. Prabhupada himself was a pure devotee. Of that nobody has any doubt of. And if a pure devotee were to instruct his devotees to take on disciples and to continue this movement, surely we must understand that such a great devotee as Srila Prabhupada must have thought things through. He must have understood who will perhaps be able to lead someone from darkness to light. Prabhupada was asked this question again, that many of his disciples, we don't have all his characteristics. So Prabhupada writes in a letter. If I find the letter, I'll give it to you, but it's at home, it's not with me here. He says in the letter, if supposing an apprentice who is learning a skill from a master, he learns the skill as just as the master has given him. And because he has learned it exactly as it is, and he simply repeats the same skill he has learned, then even if he himself personally is expert in other things, or if he himself personally is not the master, but if he can replicate 10% what the master has given him, then he will pass the test, and he will also become an engineer, and eventually he becomes a master also. So Prabhupada writes in the letter that if you follow 10% what I'm asking you to do, and you try to execute it as sincerely as you can, that following of instructions itself makes you perfect. We live in Kali Yuga, so we live in an imperfect world. But Mataji, what we forget very often is, while we look for perfection, we are seeing perfection through imperfect senses. Our own senses are imperfect. So how to find perfection if we see things through our imperfect senses? So in other words, after a while we realize that if we use the senses of our own mind, we will never come to the point of surrender. Because the mind's function is, it doesn't want you to surrender. The mind wants you to remain independent. Prabhupada says that, and Krishna says that in 5th chapter of Bhagavad Gita. He says that the nature of the mind is to remain independent. So the nature of the mind will, by itself, it will never allow you to surrender. Because surrendering to a bona fide spiritual master means, I have to change my lifestyle. I have to become more serious. I really have to now wake up in the morning and chant. I can't give the excuses. Everything has to change. So it's easier for the mind to tell you, you know what, why do you have to change? You look at all these people. They are not worth changing. You're all right. So you stay where you are. And this is how the mind expertly turns over what should be a movement towards progress into a movement of regress. So that is why, personally, I find every time I hear the dictates of the mind, I become critical of people around me. But every time I try to follow the processes given by Prabhupada, then Prabhupada gives the lenses by which we can appreciate so many wonderful qualities of devotees. Devotees who are helping us. Devotees who are inspiring us. The real point of a spiritual master is that he should change your life from what you were before, and he should make you become spiritual. If a devotee or a personality can inspire you to do that, then Prabhupada says we must fall at their lotus feet. And that can only happen if they have the qualities that are stated in Shastras, like control of the senses, mastery of the scriptures, loving personal dealings, gentle behavior. Suta Goswami is stated by the sages in Naimisharanya as having all the favors of Sukadeva Goswami given to him and all the previous masters only because of one qualification. He was very gentle. His mood was gentle and submissive. It is in Bhagavatam. So we must have the eyes to see devotees through the scriptures. If we do that, Mataji, you will find eventually that Krishna himself will reveal to you whom you can surrender to. Srinavatam swakata krishnaha punya shravana ki